God made you a promise. Praise God. How many ever have a promise from the Lord this afternoon? He's given us a promise, and He's going to keep it. He's going to keep it. He's going to see us through. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Penview. It's prayer time, and one of the things that I so thoroughly enjoy about convention is prayer time. When God's people unite their hearts together and lift their voices together. Brother Chris Dewhurst is coming to lead us in just a moment. I want to ask this. How many of you have a request on your heart you would like to be remembered this afternoon by upraised hands all across this congregation? It's hard to give requests for everybody in a congregation this size, but we have needs, don't we? And we want to take them to the Lord. We want to pray for this convention. God wants to help us this week, doesn't He? He already is. Let's pray for this convention. Let's pray for our nation. Our nation so desperately needs a fresh touch from heaven. Let's pray for the churches represented right here in this convention all across our country, churches everywhere that need the touch of God. Let's lift our voices. Let's stand together as we pray. Brother Chris Dewhurst, come and lead us. I want to hear your voices. Let's lift them together as he leads us this afternoon.
Let's pray. Kind Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to be in your presence. As we look around, we see our friends from many different places, different denominations and organizations that we know. But Lord, we're united here under one common cause, that we're caretakers of the blessed message of heart holiness. Lord, we know the solution to the chaos of sin and the disunity of politics and all that's ripping our land apart. Oh, Lord, we have within our chest the belief in the message of holiness. Lord, would you help us to take it seriously? You've listened in the weeks that have led up to this convention as churches have been on their knees and have been fasting in prayer. You've listened as those saints have prayed for lost loved ones. Lord, we ask that you would pour out the bottled up prayers of the saints in this place. Lord, would you draw us step by step closer to you? Oh, Lord, we know that the only hope for our land is if God's precious Holy Spirit is alive and well in these services, in our places of lodging, in the places of meals in this place. Lord, that you would work. Oh, would you send a revival in our hearts? Oh, would you drive us closer to our knees? Oh, Lord, would you give us a renewed fervor for the message of holiness? Lord, would there be souls who would be saved and entirely sanctified at these altars in this place? Lord, would you cause healing where there's brokenness? Would you mend relationships that have been torn apart? Lord, we know that you are the hope for this age. We know that you are the hope in this place. Draw us closer, we pray. Unite us with cords that cannot be broken. In the name of your Son, Jesus, by the power of the resurrected Savior. Amen.
So many songs of pain ringing through the air that tell of misery and how nobody seems to care. But I cannot relate my story with a tune so grim. My melody shall always be how I've been saved from sin.
I sing
because I know I'm ransomed and soul was bought at Calvary. Oh, how precious is the flow that has washed me white as snow.
I sing
because I know I'm ransomed and redeemed. What a miracle of love mercy is today. The sin that I could not atone has all been washed away. The cross that Jesus bore for me shall be my song of praise. His sacrifice has paid the price and covered me with grace.
I sing
because I know I'm ransomed and redeemed.
I sing
because my soul was bought at Calvary. Oh, how precious is the flow that has washed me white as snow.
I sing
because I know I'm ransomed and redeemed. Oh, how precious is the flow that has washed me white as snow.
View. That was very good. We're going to have the ushers give you something. While you're in Gatlinburg, we have an invitation that you can give to waitresses, people you see in the hotel, people you see on the street. Of course, if you're going to give it to your waitress, make sure you leave a good tip and be friendly about it. Amen? So they're going to pass these out. Take a stack of these or one or two. And if all of you invite somebody to the Gatlinburg services, it's going to fill this place up tonight and tomorrow night. Thursday night, this is just something we want to do while we're in Gatlinburg. Since we've been here, this is our fourth year, we have noticed how many more people come in here than in Dayton. And so that's always a neat thing for us. And we want to be a good representation. We had the convention center, this starting our fourth year here, told us, and this is maybe what they tell everybody that rents here, but I believe them. They said, you are our best group that we host in the Gatlinburg Convention Center. Congratulations to you. And they also said you're also the most organized group that comes into our convention center. Take that. I'll tell you, it's not my fault. It's the fault of Stephen Cassidy and Nathan Weaver, and a great host of volunteers who really are incredible. Thank you so very, very much. Now, just a few announcements. It's just absolutely necessary. We tell you that we want you to register. You'll get an event book that is the map to all things Gatlinburg 2024. In here will be how you can give, which we're going to make that very easy for you. We're going to be taking an offering in just a minute. And here's a map of the convention center. It'll tell you where the cafeteria is. Things are improving here. In the cafeteria, you can actually go there and get a meal. That's an improvement, and it's not bad. It's really good food. And here's a map of the local dining, a map of our shuttle system. We have shuttles that are going to be running, both golf carts, and the Burlington Bible Church and the Lebanon God's Missionary Church are letting us use their shuttle buses for this year. And so we hope that'll help you. The concessions are open for meals. There's all kinds of information, the future dates. You need this book. Make sure you register and get it. We have a nursery upstairs overlooking the auditorium and something brand new. We're going to see if it works. If nobody uses it and you're not worried about it and it doesn't work, we'll never have to do it again. But we do have a staffed nursery. We've had families come for the first time. Maybe they're even new families to church. And, you know, to struggle with their children all day long. This has been requested. We're going to try it. If it doesn't work, we don't have to do it again. But on the second floor is Convention Kids Staff Nursery. We have qualified people there for 1 to 4 year olds for the main services. It's upstairs towards Parkway this way. And there will be signage there and people to check you in. Youth Zone is happening in the Mills Center, Youth Services. Visit our exhibitors. If somebody could not come, tell them about live streaming at ihconvention.com. Follow us on social media. And when something good happens, and you'll be doing this all day long, but when something good happens, share it. Share it. It's just like giving a gospel tract. Do that. Tomorrow, or the rest of this day is going to be great. This evening is the Front Lines of the Harvest at 6 p.m. Evening worship service at 7:15. Let's pray for a great day here, the first day of Gatlinburg 24. Over here are prayer rooms. I hope your church is like mine, Sunday evenings before the evening service, revival meeting before the evening service. We have a place for the ladies to pray, a place for the men to pray. I think it's like the engine room of the service. That's how I have felt. I'd like to have an engine room right here. It's much more fun to visit with all of our friends, but if you could take a few minutes, get over here to these rooms and join people in prayer on behalf of the service tonight, I believe God would honor it. And so help us in the place of prayer. We have some young folks who will help us in some of our prayers. They have great faith. Sean Sanders, come here. You've been coming to this convention since you were carried into this convention. And we appreciate that good trio that sang in the last service. How many enjoyed the Sanders brothers singing? You know, they were more cute when they were little, but now they're growing up and, well, they're still doing a good job. But I believe, Sean, you're a man of faith and you can pray over this offering. We need more money than you and me can even comprehend. I don't even know how much we need, but it's going to be way over 100,000, maybe even up to 200,000. But God owns the cattle in 1,000 hills. There's a lot of hills around here. He's going to have a cattle auction, sell some of those cows, and God is going to provide the need. Thank you for your giving from this start of the convention. And Brother Sean, would you pray over the offering, please?
Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for this convention. Bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you.
you. Thank you for the offering this afternoon and your faithful giving. Thank you for being here. We're so glad you're here for this convention 2024, and we're expecting God to help us, aren't we? Amen. Amen. For our keynote address, we have Brother David Fulton coming to us from Frankfort, Indiana. We want to hear what God has to say to us through him. The Mark Calderon family is coming to sing for us just before he preaches. Let's keep our hearts open and make it easy for them to minister in song and in word this afternoon as they come.
Our family has just broken in to singing in front of people. The kids said, "Mom, I can't do this. We can't sing in front of all these people." I said, "Oh, nobody's going to be there. What are you all doing here? This is 2:45. This is nap time." Thank you for being here. This song that we're going to sing is not a new song to your ears. You're going to hear it over and over again because it's called Over and Over Again. Can we talk of God's faithfulness too much? We cannot. And I feel like it's our responsibility to especially remind you of God's faithfulness. This girl right here is the girl that you prayed for, many of you prayed for. In the fall, we had a very close brush with losing her. And 10 days in the ICU, and let me tell you, our faith was built. But let me also tell you this. He told me over and over again, he said, "You're going to come through this and be able to say, I've proven it true. What he says, what I say," he was telling me, "what I say I'm going to do." And he did that. He proved himself true to us. And over again in the past few months, he's shown his faithfulness to our family. And we cannot express our thankfulness enough. And that's what we want to encourage you to do this afternoon, is to remember the times that he's been faithful and expect him to continue to be faithful in your needs. I've stood on the bank of a wide raging river, trusting that I'd get across. And I've made my way through some valleys and deserts, believing that I would never get lost. I've stood at the foot of what felt like Mount Everest, knowing I'd have the strength for the climb. But through every test and each trial, he's taught me one thing is sure every time. Over and over, again and again, God is faithful. Over and over, again and again, through it all, he's made me able to stand and survive, to come through alive when it sure looked like I couldn't win. Jesus is with me, so I claim the victory over and over again. If you ask me why, I have no hesitation. God does what he says he will do. And I'd simply say every battle has taught me there's nothing that he won't help me through. So why should I dwell on the hardships and struggles when I look just beyond them? I see the way this will end is with great celebration. Deep in my heart, I believe. Over and over, again and again, God is faithful. Over and over, again. Couldn't wait. Jesus.
So I claim the victory over and over again. Over and over again and again, God is faithful. Over and over again and again through it all, He's made me able to stand and survive, to come through a lie when it sure looked like I couldn't win. Jesus is with me, so I claim the victory over and over. Is with me, so I claim the victory over and over again.
Because He is with me, I claim the victory. Because He is faithful, I can stand. Because of Him. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm glad He is faithful, that He can answer prayer, that He can do what needs to be done, whether it's heal or take home. I am glad I serve a faithful God who will always do what is best for me, that He loves me so much that He always works in my best interest. I'm glad I have a faithful God. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm glad He is with me. Praise God, praise God. Well, it is so good to see this good-looking crowd here on the opening night of IH Convention. Now, by good-looking, I mean that collectively, not necessarily individually, but it is good to see all of you here tonight. Isn't it wonderful to get together and worship with those of like precious faith? You know, we got a big family. You look around and brothers and sisters everywhere. One thing I found out about family, friends you get to pick. Family, you just stuck with them. Look around, you stuck with them. But it is good to be here at IH Convention. We're trusting the Lord to come and minister to us this week. I've asked Him to come and minister. If He doesn't come, this is just a gathering of like-minded people. No different than the Elks Club or the Lions Club or any other club, just like-minded people getting together. But when He comes, that separates everything. When He comes and He steps in and He ministers and He moves and He works, it makes it worth the drive, worth the money, worth the exhaustion to come to IH Convention. I've been asking Him to come and I've been looking for Him to come. Trusting Him to come. Our theme this year, I don't know if you've noticed that or not, sin, man's problem, holiness, God's solution. Oh, there's nothing worse than having a problem and no solution for the problem. Now, there are some people that have problems that you don't have that problem, you've never faced that problem, but this is a problem that is universal. In fact, Romans chapter 3 and verse 23 tells us, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Where you live, you may face problems that where I live, we don't face those problems. Where I live, we face problems that maybe you will never face wherever it is that you live. But the sin problem is a problem that affects all men everywhere. And I'm here to tell you, sin is the biggest problem that this world has. Sin is the biggest problem that this world faces. We talk or we hear on the news media a lot of times, well, this is the problem, or that is the problem, or race issues are the problem, or hunger is the problem, or this is the problem. No, sin is the biggest problem this world has ever and will ever face. Sin is the issue that drives all of the hostility in this world. Sin is the reason that children are neglected. Sin is the reason that homes are broken. Sin is the reason that scars are made. It's because of sin. Sin is the biggest problem that we face. But I'm glad there is a solution to the problem of sin. I'm glad that there is a cure. But I meet people, and as I talk with them, they say, well, if sin is the biggest problem, what is the cause of sin? Well, let's go back to Genesis chapter 3, because that's where we find where sin comes into the picture. Genesis chapter 3, way back in the beginning of the world, I was not there back then. I just look old. I'm not quite that old. Some of you, I'm wondering, but most of you, I don't worry about it. But it's a long time ago. God spoke the worlds into existence. Isn't it wonderful that our God spoke, that we didn't crawl out of some primordial ooze somewhere and eventually evolve into something that we are, and we're nothing more than just a collection of cells? I am glad that the God of the universe spoke and it happened. Perfect world. Everything was perfect. Perfect garden, perfect fellowship, perfect. Everything was exactly as God intended for it to be. He gave Adam and Eve one instruction. You can eat everything else. Don't eat of that one tree. One tree. Out of all of the trees, out of all of the fruit, out of all of the garden, one tree. But that one tree, they ate. And sin entered the world. Because they willfully transgressed God's law. God said no, and they did it anyway. It was a willful transgression. It was not a mistake. It was not a poor choice. It wasn't anything else. Let's call it what it is. It was sin. And I'm here to tell you today, the same definition of sin that was in the garden is the same today. If you willfully transgress what God has said, let's call it what it is. It is still sin. It's not a poor choice. It's not a bad direction. It is sin. Let's call it what it is. Sin is still a willful transgression of God's law. God says no and you do, it's sin. God says you have to and you don't, it's sin, because you are willfully choosing to not do what God says to do. Sin is still sin. That's where sin came in. There was a cause of sin. Willful transgression is still the cause of sin today. Because of sin, there was a curse that came with sin. We begin to see this in the third chapter of Genesis. In verse 14, we see the curse strikes the animals. Let me just tell you something. Sin always curses people everywhere. There are people that say, hey, my sin only affects me. My sin only bothers me. I'm here to tell you, sin always affects more people than just you. Sin always causes problems, even among the innocent. Go with me on this soggy night up to a cemetery, and there, laying in that cemetery, is two children of a family who were wiped out because a man drank and crossed the center line and hurled them into eternity. Sin always affects more people. Walk the city streets of the towns where you live and watch the hurting children, the broken homes. It's all because of sin. Sin destroys everything it touches. Sin never makes anything better. There's a curse that comes with sin. Curse falls on all the animals. You see that in verse 14. When he's talking to the serpent, he said, you're cursed above all the rest of them. All of them are going to be cursed. And now you have the curse on the animals. You have the curse on the land. You see that in verses 17 and 18. Let me tell you something. Every time I weed my garden, I get more frustrated with Adam. Weeds in your garden are a result of sin. It's a constant reminder that sin has a price tag. Sin has a cost associated with it, and we need to understand there is a cost for sin. Sin caused sin curse landed on all the human race. It affected all of the human race because of Adam and Eve's sin. Now all of us are cursed by sin. I have grandchildren. I have 11 grandchildren, 10 here, one waiting on me in heaven. I love my grandbabies. Oh, they are the light of my life. My kids, not so much, but I love my grandkids. Oh, I love them. I hold those precious little sweet, innocent children in my arms, and I think there is no way that anything could be more perfect. But then I am reminded, because of sin, they are also born under that sin curse. As perfect as I think they are, as innocent as they appear to be, they will come to the day when they reach the age of accountability and sin will begin to grow in their life because they are under the curse of sin. David said, he was born in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. It wasn't an illicit affair. It was the fact he understood the depravity of the human heart because of sin. Sin fell on the entire human race. Sin has a price tag, though. There's a cost for sin. The first thing I want to notice in verse 16, pain comes because of sin. God, speaking to the woman, says, "You will bear children with pain." Pain comes into the picture because of sin. I'm here to tell you there is always a price tag of pain with sin. Sin always brings pain. Sin brought death. We notice that in Hebrews 9:27, it is appointed unto man once to die. You know, death is something that none of us will escape. Death is something that comes to the rich and the poor, the good and the bad, the good-looking and the ugly, the chubby and the skinny. It doesn't matter what you are. Death is waiting on you. Boy, isn't that encouraging? That's a result of sin. Death comes because of sin. Physical death is a part of sin. I've buried loved ones that I loved. They were precious, but they're gone. Why? Because death comes as a result of sin. There is always a price tag with sin, and part of the price tag with sin is death. Not just physical death, but spiritual death. Ephesians 2:1 says, "And you hath he quickened," or made alive, "who were dead in trespasses and sin." We were born dead. That's the paradox of life. All of us were born dead in trespasses and sin. We were born dead and away from God. Every individual born is born under the curse of sin. There's a price tag to sin. Not only did it cause death, but it caused separation. We see right there in the garden, that perfect place where they had perfect harmony. Adam and Eve lived in perfect harmony, fellowshipping together every day in the cool of the day. God came and walked and talked with them. How neat would that have been to have God come and walk right beside you in the cool of the day? Now, I know there's some debate on when the cool of the day is. Us morning people, we think it's early in the morning. You know, if God's going to come and walk and talk with me, he better do it early, because late of an evening, no, I'm face down in my Cheerios, I'm done, I'm asleep. Others of you wake up at the crack of noon, and you're awake until late night. So God couldn't walk and talk with you because you can't walk and talk early in the morning. I don't know when God met with them, but God met with them every single day. How neat would that have been to walk in fellowship with God? But on that fateful day, when they ate that fruit, God came looking for them, calling, "Adam! Adam, where are you?" What happened? Sin had separated, torn it apart. Adam and Eve had been in such close fellowship. And now, standing before God, God confronts them for their sin. And what does Adam say? It's her fault. That home that it had harmony now has disharmony. That home that it had peace now has conflict because of sin. Sin causes separation. That's what makes one race hate another. That's what makes one nation hate another. That's what makes one class hate another. It's the separation caused by sin. I'm here to tell you that type of separation only comes from the pit of hell, because that's always what the devil wants, is separation. Not only did it separate Adam and Eve, but it separated God from man. That relationship that had once been so perfect is now broken. They no longer can walk with God in the cool of the day. In fact, they're driven out of the garden. You see that in verses 23 and 24. God drives them out of the garden. They have to leave where they had once walked and talked with God. Now that fellowship is broken. Now that relationship is broken. Now, because of sin, separation has come in, and no longer do they have the fellowship with God that they had once had, and it wasn't God's fault. Sin causes separation. It separated God from man. And if that's where the story ended, wouldn't that be depressing? If that's where the story ended, that would be so depressing. But I'm here to tell you that is not where the story ends. Because in the midst of this dismal failure, in the midst of this awful story that's taking place there in Genesis 3, in verse 15, you see God makes a promise that he would provide a cure for sin. Oh, yes, there's a cost to sin. Yes, there is a price tag. But I'm here to tell you there is a cure for the sin problem. Right there in verse 15, God gives the promise that he would provide a cure for sin. And there in the garden, he instituted the sacrificial system that was pointing to the day when Jesus himself would pay the perfect sacrifice. There in the garden, God began to put into place, in faith, believing that the perfect sacrifice would come and pay redemption's price for sin. You see, God loved us too much to leave us in despair. But he promised a cure for sin. But it required a blood sacrifice. And over the years and the centuries, the blood of bulls and goats is sacrificed repeatedly by all who believe, not just the children of Israel, but even those before the children of Israel. Every sacrifice pointed to the day when Jesus would carry his cross up Golgotha's hill, and he would be nailed to that cross, and his blood would pour on the sands of time and wash away all sin, because there is a cure for sin. And that cure is the blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, I bring you good news today. There is a cure for sin. Doesn't matter how bad you've been. Doesn't matter how awful you've been. But I'm here to tell you, on that day when Jesus shed his blood there on the sands of time, when Jesus paid that price, he didn't pay it with a caveat that said, I can erase most sin. No, I'm here to tell you, he told us in his word, 1 John 1:9, if you will confess your sin, he is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and cleanse of all unrighteousness. Oh, I'm glad there's not an asterisk there. You all know what an asterisk is for? It's to let you know who doesn't qualify. You get a card in the mail and it talks about, oh, you can buy a brand new Lincoln Town Car for $1. You always look for the asterisk, don't you? And that asterisk says, yes, if you're there between 12 and 12:01 on every third Thursday of every 76th month, you can get it for $1. In other words, no, you don't qualify. I remember one time I got a card in the mail and it told me that I had qualified to win, and I don't remember the exact number. It was like $1,375.46. It was an odd number of airline dollars, so I could buy airline tickets and fly. And at that time, I still had grandkids down in Florida, and I thought to myself, man, I will fly to Florida and see my grandkids. If the kids are there, fine. If not, fine. I'm going to go see my grandkids. So I put the card in the car, and I began to drive across the miles, and I called the number, the 800 number, and a lady answered. I told her who I was and why I was calling, and she said, oh, Mr. Fulton, I'm so glad you called. I just have a couple of questions to make sure you qualify. I said, okay. She said, the first question, are you over 18? And I thought, well, honey, you ain't looking at me or you'd never ask that question. Yes, ma'am, I'm over 18. Oh, that's wonderful, Mr. Fulton. Are you married, dating, or have a significant other? I said, I'm married. Oh, that's wonderful, Mr. Fulton. Then she said, do you make over X number of dollars a year? And I said, no, ma'am, I don't. She said, no, don't worry. It can be your combined income. I said, ma'am, that was my combined income. And you know what she told me? Oh, you don't qualify. And the line went dead. Didn't matter how good the news was if you don't qualify. But oh, I bring you good news, you qualify today. That's why he said in John chapter 3 and verse 16, that whosoever believeth. Oh, I'm glad he said it's for whosoever will. I'm glad he opened it up with that in mind, that whoever sins, there is a cure for sin. And the blood of Jesus Christ is the cure for sin. Oh, I bring you good news today. You don't have to live in sin. You don't have to struggle in sin. You don't have to be that way. There is a cure. A number of years ago, my daddy was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. They told him, Mr. Fulton, we're so sorry, but outside of divine healing, there is no cure for Parkinson's. Oh, they have things they can do to try to help you, to try to extend your life, and my dad did every single one of them that he possibly could, and it did lengthen his life. But I watched as it ravaged his body, robbed him of his mind, took away his mobility, took away everything, and eventually took his life. You know, I've thought of that many times since we buried him. How frustrated I would be if someone came to me and said, you know what? For a number of years, I've had the cure for Parkinson's, but I just didn't want to tell anybody. I'd want to just hug you real tight. That'd be frustrating, wouldn't it? How frustrating would it be to the sinner to know you know the solution and you haven't told them the solution? The solution is the blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, I'm here to tell you, how much must you hate the world to not tell them there is a cure? There is a cure! There is a cure! Hallelujah! I'm here to tell you, you can't listen to anything today without hearing 9,476 commercials for some kind of drug that cures everything but causes a lot of stuff. Oh, I'm glad that this cure has no side effects. Unless you want to count peace as a side effect. Unless you want to count contentment as a side effect. Unless you want to count being guilt-free as a side effect. Unless you want to count living for God as a side effect. Yes, those are the side effects of the blood of Jesus Christ. But it still cures all sin. You say, but preacher, you don't know where I've been, what I've done. Don't need to know. And it doesn't matter to me, because even if I did know, there'd be nothing I could do about it. But he knows. He was there. He saw it. And he still forgives all sin. Oh, I bring you good news. Sin is the problem. Jesus is the cure. There is a cure. There is a remedy. His name is Jesus Christ. I want our musicians to come to the piano. I don't know if you're here tonight, this afternoon. You slipped into this service. Maybe you're watching online. I don't know. But maybe you're struggling with a sin problem. Oh, I want to bring you good news today. There is a cure. There is a remedy. His name is Jesus Christ. No matter how far you've fallen, you've not gone beyond the reach of my Lord. You've not gone beyond what the blood of Jesus Christ can still forgive. Oh, you may struggle forgiving yourself, but he doesn't struggle forgiving you. His blood still saves from all sin. You don't have to leave here this afternoon with the same guilt you came in with. You don't have to leave here this afternoon with the same burden you came in with. There is a remedy. There is a cure. You don't have to leave with the same disease that robbed you of your life. There is a remedy. There is a remedy. His name is Jesus Christ. Just a couple of weeks ago, I buried my brother-in-law, born and raised in a pastor's home, grew up in a Christian home. Something went horribly wrong. He backslid and went away from God for years and years. Lived a life of sin. We worried, prayed, oh God, do something to get Rod back to God. Do something to get him to you. We would try to talk to him, but he wasn't very receptive. We tried ministering to him, but he wouldn't hear. And we prayed, and God heard. About 6 years ago, he was diagnosed with multiple myeloma, incurable cancer. They tried everything. He fought that bravely for all those years. But in that fight, he found the one who could still forgive from all sin. He found the one that brings the cure, not physically cured. His body was ravaged by the disease, but his heart is at home with God today. Why? Because there is a remedy. Jesus Christ is still the remedy. Last time I got to talk to my brother-in-law alive, I was between meetings. I rushed in. I only had a short time to spend with him. And I made my way to his room. And the difference. The difference that the gospel makes. No longer was there the resistance. No longer was there the stiff arm, the not wanting to hear. But there were open arms, and we rejoiced in the love and the grace of Jesus. But he told me, he said, David, tell him, don't waste the years like I wasted the years. Get saved today. Don't waste the time. And so I want to tell you this afternoon, if you're away from God, you're not beyond the reach of God. Don't waste another day. Find him as your Savior. He's still waiting with open arms to redeem you. Let's stand. And if you need to come and pray, I want to give you an invitation, an opportunity to make your way here to the altar, and you'll find the same thing that I found, that Rod found, that my dad found, that so many others have found, that the blood of Jesus Christ is still the cure from all sin. Doesn't matter what you've done, doesn't matter where you've gone, the blood is still the cure. And if you want to pray, I can't think of a better way to spend a Tuesday afternoon than getting rid of a sin burden, being reunited, that broken relationship mended through the blood of Jesus. Anybody want to come and pray? Jesus loves you too much to just leave you go. He went to Calvary's cross so that you could be redeemed. Sin is the problem. Jesus is the cure. Anybody want to come and pray? Jesus, thank you for being willing to leave heaven's splendor and coming to earth's squalor to bleed and suffer and die so that we might be redeemed. Father, you know every heart here. You know every heart watching online. And I know that you are a faithful God and you will minister to them. Thank you, Jesus, for your great love, for your abundant mercy, and for your forgiveness from sin. Go with us from this service. Continue to minister to us this week, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you for your kind attention. You are dismissed.